And good evening to those who are joining us from MENA region, and good evening to those joining us from South Asia and Far East. I'm Amrita Nayak, Program Director at XED. Extremely happy to connect with you and thank you for taking interest in Cornell's Executive Program in Management. Appreciate your time to learn about it, think about it, think about what it might be like for you, your career, or the network of people that you will connect with as part of this program. Today, we are extremely glad to have with us Dr. Derek Cabrera, who is joining us from Ithaca, New York. But before I hand over to Dr. Cabrera, I would like to share a few thoughts and give you an overview about this program. As leaders of tomorrow, one needs to learn and unlearn constantly. You need to build the deep expertise and wide knowledge base that is required to survive in this VUCA world. And to thrive in this ecosystem, you need to build the right mindset and expertise which this program is designed to offer. Allow me to take you through this brief deck and the program highlights for your better understanding. So over a period spanning 6 months, you will have live interactive sessions led by Cornell faculty. You're going to be in a live classroom session, which means you get to, on real-time basis, interact with the faculty and your peers. There are breakout discussions with peers, query resolution with faculty, all of which happen live during the session. You're taught by some of the finest faculties in the university. They're based out of either New York City or Ithaca. Upon successfully completing the program, you also get a Cornell certificate signed by the dean and the faculty director. To ensure you have optimum learning experience, the cohort size is limited. This also ensures that you get an opportunity to connect and know your peers better. We also have an engagement to ensure peer learning, what we call as the peer coaching. So although the course is for 6 months, you have access to eCornell on-demand library for a period of 1 year. The on-demand library, what we call as the electives, are primarily self-paced modules that you undertake at your convenience. And there are 1,200 such electives to choose from. As I mentioned earlier, there are 16 live sessions. There is work which goes on before and after each session. So each session will have some sort of a pre-work to ensure that you are sufficiently oriented for the session, and some sort of a post-work, which will give you an opportunity to reflect on what you have learned. The program is led by the faculty director, Dr. Alan Filipowicz. Dr. Filipowicz is the former dean of executive education at Cornell and will be the teaching faculty as well on this program. On his academic background, he did his post-graduation from Cornell, his MBA from Wharton, and his PhD from Harvard. This is a sample certificate of what you will get once you successfully complete the program. This is a brief overview of our participants from past and current cohort. The average work experience of our participants has been 18 to 20 years, majority of whom are founders and directors, head of businesses, region heads, vice presidents, to just name a few. We have participants from across industries, IT and technology firms like Google, Microsoft, IBM, Cisco, consulting firms like BCG, McKinsey, EY, banking and financial firms like Credit Suisse, HDFC, ICICI, just to name a few. These are some of the testimonials that we have from our past participants, mentioning how well the program helped them. And finally, the program begins on 21st of Jan, and your last date to enroll is 27th October. So we hope you take out the time to think about what this program may mean for you and your career. And with that, we begin our masterclass on systems thinking led by Professor Derek Cabrera, also a teaching faculty on this program. To give you a brief overview on Dr. Cabrera, he's an internationally known systems scientist, an author, a TED speaker, and a faculty of Cornell University. He also serves in the United States Military Academy. Prior to becoming a scientist, Professor Cabrera worked for 15 years around the world as a mountain guide and experiential educator. Dr. Cabrera, a pleasure having you here with us. Without any further ado, I hand it over to you.
Thank you, Amrita. I'm going to share my screen here. Okay, Can you all see that?
Yes, we can.
Okay. So one of the things that you'll be engaging in this program is called systems thinking. And this is kind of an overview of really two semesters of courses, graduate level courses at Cornell on systems thinking and systems leadership. And so you can see that systems thinking really is the base of how we think, how we form mental models, how we learn, how that learning kind of becomes organizational learning, and then how that organizational learning drives your capacity to do the mission of the organization and bring about the vision of the organization. All of this is, contained in, like I said, two courses here at Cornell, graduate level courses that are 16 weeks long, and you get it in a shorter dose. And also two books on the topic, Systems Thinking Made Simple and Flock Not Clock. So let me give you a little bit of background of kind of why we do systems thinking and what it's good for. You might have heard this term VUCA, and VUCA just means volatile, uncertain, complex, and ambiguous. And it's a pretty good term or set of terms really that explains how the world of business, the world of organizations, and really just the world in general, how it operates. The world is volatile, uncertain, complex, and ambiguous, and increasingly so as we increase globalization and interconnectedness. And we all see this and have been a part of this with COVID and all the different things that are going on around the world recently. Now, the problem isn't that the world is VUCA. That's just sort of something that we all have to get accustomed to and deal with in our everyday lives and in our work. The problem is that our thinking tends to be what I call LAMO, which means linear, anthropocentric, which just means kind of human-centered, mechanistic, meaning we think sort of machine-like, and overly ordered. And so let me give you a couple examples so that this makes a little more sense. The real world is dynamic and adaptive and organic and constantly evolving, yet we tend to think in very machine-like or mechanistic ways. We say things like the universe is like a clock, which the universe is really nothing like a clock. And we say things like the brain is like a computer. And of course, the brain really doesn't resemble a computer very much. The brain's kind of a 3-pound, enfolded, very creative, sometimes irrational thing. And computers are binary and brains are multivalent. So the real world is, like I said, multivalent. That means that and both can be true, right? Yet our thinking is needlessly bivalent, meaning either or. So we sometimes call this the genius of both and versus the tyranny of either or. And a simple question can reveal how meaningful this is. Do your customers want your products or services to be faster or cheaper? Well, of course, the answer is both. So we live in a very and both world where it's not always an either or kind of situation, but our thinking tends to be very either or what we call binary or bivalent, meaning just two poles. The real world is networked and it's nested and complex, and it even has a sprinkling of randomness. Yet we tend to think of things in very ordered, static, unchanging categories and hierarchies. Yet those things are changing constantly. And the real world is nonlinear and includes feedback, and it actually includes what we call webs of causality, right? But we tend to think in very linear and causal ways that this causes this, and we kind of oversimplify it, when in reality, everything that exists really has a web of causes behind it. And finally, the real world is very much agnostic or doesn't really care about human endeavors, right? It's just going on and things are complex and VUCA. We are relatively small and insignificant, yet we tend, in fact, our whole brain and nervous system is sort of designed for us to look through our human-centered lens. And sometimes when we do that, we misunderstand systems. And that's called anthropocentrism, which is just a big word for human-centered. We sort of think the world revolves around us, but in reality, we're relatively small and insignificant. So the world is VUCA, but our thinking is not in alignment with that world. It's very, what I call LAMO. And so what we need to do is sort of change our LAMO thinking and replace it with systems thinking. And luckily, our research has shown that there's four fundamental rules or simple things that you can follow that will help you do more systems thinking and less LAMO. And those rules are called DSRP, which is just an acronym for the four rules: distinctions, systems, relationships, and perspectives. And so we make distinctions, we group things into part whole systems, we relate things, in, you know, how the action affects the reaction of things. And we do all that from different perspectives. And that's in this overview, we're not going to go deep into this, but in the course, we'll kind of go more deeply into those four things that you can practice and get better. And just to give you a sense of this, this is from research that we did. People were exposed to less than 1 minute of these four patterns, where we made them aware of these patterns and taught them in less than a minute. And it significantly, this is highly significant findings, significantly improved the complexity and robustness of their thinking. And what this means really is that we, in less than a minute, we were able to get them more sophisticated about their analysis, more depth in their analysis. They saw more things that previously went unseen. So they saw things that other people missed. They took more perspectives or points of view and were generally more systemic and did better analyses and better problem solving, and even had higher emotional intelligence, which is critically important when it comes to thinking, because sometimes our emotions cloud or get in the way of our thinking. And just another study that I'll share with you, this one had 35,000 people in it, showed what people do when they're asked to think about something, to, you know, anything, any, your job, a project, a product, whatever it is that you're thinking about, or even, you know, your kids or, and your family or things like that, or society. And 48% of people kind of froze up when they were asked to think about something. And that's really important, because that means 48%, almost half of people, generally don't know what to do when we ask them to think about something. But for those who did think about it and were able to sort of start thinking about it, we noticed that they did certain things. And you don't have to zoom into those numbers or anything, but you can see that those things decreased radically in percentages. But what that tells us is this slide really hits on the left is what people tend to do. They tend to do these four things. And on the right are things that they can do, very specific things that they can do to improve their thinking, their analysis, their synthesis, their emotional intelligence, their ability to see systems, understand systems, and come up with better decisions, better problem solving, more emotional intelligence, that kind of thing. So again, you don't have to read all those things on the right, but what this research shows us and what the course goes into is how you do more of the stuff on the right and continue doing the stuff on the left, which most people tend to do. But really it's the stuff on the right that increases your systems thinking. And the final piece of research that I'll just share with you is This study included a sample of over 1,000 people. And we see that what's sometimes referred to as the Dunning-Kruger effect, which means that a person's confidence is higher than their competence. So what we show in this research is that people's confidence in their abilities of thinking and systems thinking is actually higher than their competence. And so obviously we don't want that to be the case. We want them to be relatively matched. And so we can work on that is the point. We can get better at that. Now, how is this relevant? I mean, the World Economic Forum puts out the 21st century skills list. This is 10 skills, all of which are predicated on these four patterns. So in other words, if you want to get any of those skills on the left, any of those kinds of skills, like analytical thinking or innovation or learning or creativity or critical thinking or even leadership, social influence, emotional intelligence, et cetera. If you want to get those skills on the left, those are actually outcomes. And so you can't work on an outcome. What you have to do is work on the inputs. And the inputs are distinction-making, part-whole systems or part organizing things into part-whole groupings, relating things in a particular way, and taking perspectives. And so if you get good at these four things on the right, then you're going to see those outcomes on the left. And finally, I'll just leave you with one more point, which is you may have heard of the work, the Nobel Prize winning work of Daniel Kahneman, where he explained that we really have two really powerful thinking modes. The first he called System One, and it's the one we use 95% of the time. And it's intuitive and it's emotional, it's autonomic, it happens automatically, and it's fast, which is the best part of it. But it has one downside, which is that it's highly prone to error, meaning we make a lot of mistakes when we're in System One thinking. Now, System Two thinking is more serial, it's kind of loop thinking, it's more aware, you're more aware of the thinking that you're doing, it's more systemic, meaning it's you're seeing more of the system. It's taking in information and evidence and using that as feedback. But its big downside is that it's slow. So while it is more accurate than System One thinking, the problem is it's slow. And we live in a pretty fast-paced society. So having your thinking be slow when you need it to be fast, or having your thinking be fast when you need it to be right, you sort of end up in this binary, like, which one are we going to choose? Well, the great thing is you don't have to choose, because we have what's called System Three thinking. And our research shows that these practicing these four fundamental thinking habits, distinctions, systems, relationships, and perspectives, and really just practicing them on a daily basis increases the speed and accuracy of your thinking. And this gives you a third option, which is fast thinking that also ends up being more accurate or right. So sometimes we say slow is smooth and smooth is fast. So if you slow it down and practice these principles or these four rules to the point where you get smooth with them, then you can go take that smoothness of thinking and you can think very fast in different situations. And in fact, we use this with the special forces and Olympic athletes and people that have to think in very challenging environments that are very fast moving. And so I'll leave it there and then open it up. We can open it up for, questions or something like that. But generally speaking, what the goal is to expose you to these four patterns, distinctions, systems, relationships, and perspectives, and get you to practice them and begin a practice of them. And within even a few weeks of practicing, and they're simple practicing kind of things, you will see your thinking increase in its specificity, in being able to see things that others don't see, in being able to see things in yourself and in others and situations, and essentially problem solve better, make better decisions, and do it faster. You'll be kind of the faster person in the room and you'll also have kind of more creative ideas and better better thinking about whatever system that you're thinking about. And again, that could be products or services. It could be the way you do meetings. It could be the way you're setting up a new project. Or like I said, it could be not just in your professional life, but in your personal life, how you're dealing with your kids, or how you're working with your partner and your family, and social problems, all those kinds of things. So really, thinking becomes one of the most important tools that humans have, and we use it for everything. So if you can improve thinking, you can improve everywhere. And that's systems thinking made simple. That's sort of what you're going to be exposed to in the course.
Wonderful. Thanks so much, Professor. We have quite a few questions from the people who are watching us today. Maybe we can take a couple of few. So let me go on the first question. So we have a question from Stephen, and he asks, I work for a global telecom company in a technology role. Can you provide an example of how systems thinking is relevant for me?
Yeah. So lots of technical teams use systems thinking to build shared mental models of their processes and their systems, all the different systems and processes that they work with or that they're trying to make better. So systems thinking is going to help you make your processes better. It's going to help you understand your systems better, not only during a project, to make things better, but also especially at the beginning of projects or initiatives where you're kind of laying things out. Systems thinking is an effective tool for better understanding technological systems as much as it is for understanding human systems and interactions. So sometimes, most of the time, one of the problems we make is we separate technological and human systems. And we call those socio-technical systems. And most systems are embedded in both, right? Most systems have humans in them and technology. And being able to see both of those types of systems together is really critical. But getting teams on the same page is really important, especially before we invest time and money into projects and initiatives. That's one of the major benefits of learning systems thinking in any organization. Systems thinking is also a great tool for managing teams or task management or quarterly objectives. I'll tell you, there was a vice president of a multinational company, vice president of engineering, came to me after a talk and said, give me one thing that I can, I'm going to go back to my crew right now and give me one idea that I can use right away. This is, I loved your talk, all that, but give me an idea that I can go back right now and use. And so I just drew on a napkin at the podium, three circles, concentric circles. And I said, say you're assigning a task at the level of the center circle. Just ask that taskmaster, the person in charge of that task, to think plus one, minus one. So when they think about that task, think about one level up, how that task is contextualized by one level up and what that task looks like one level down. And that actually creates sort of systemic thinking and what sometimes we call enterprise thinking. It also starts getting people to think in terms of like strategic, operational, and tactical kinds of issues. So you're thinking at multiple levels at once. And so just like something as simple as plus one, minus one. Anyway, he said, oh, that's great. And he started to walk away and he turned back and he said, hey, can I keep that napkin? And I said, sure, and he took it back to his teams and really had a great success with just that very simple thing. Obviously, that's one little example of what we can do with, that's just called part whole thinking, but there's many more. And certainly the most prevalent issue that we see in organizations is what sometimes are called silos and the impact that silos have on interdepartmental work and communication. And systems thinking offers some very powerful solutions for lessening silos and solving silo problems. So that those are just a few examples that I would give you.
Sure. Thank you for that. We have one more question, and that's from Ishita. And she is asking, what are the skills needed by an individual to engage in systems thinking and ensure there are no blind spots left?
That's a great question, and something that lots of people want to know. So the nice thing is the four skills that we talked about, D, S, R, and P, distinctions, systems, relationships, and perspectives, have been shown, like I showed you in that slide, to be effective, very effective, especially when we combine them together. And so the ability to make distinctions between identity and other, these two variables of how distinctions are made, the ability to see how a system is organized into parts and wholes, the ability to see how an action relates to a reaction and in turn builds webs of causality in the system, and the ability to take different points of view or use perspective to both limit or expand our thinking. Those four skills will do as good as we can do to eliminate blind spots. Now, you're not going to eliminate every blind spot. We're always going to have some blind spots because we can't know the future and things like that. But the goal is to really minimize those, the ones that we probably should have seen or could have seen that create unintended consequences or things down the road that we didn't want to happen. So those four skills are really the way that you do it, and you just practice those four. And research shows that we can increase effectiveness in all domains.
Understood. So we'll take one final question, and this is from Myra, and she's asking, are MNCs currently using systems thinking? And can you share some examples of such organization?
Yeah, I mean, you know, hundreds of MNCs are using systems thinking at all different levels of the organization. Let me think some examples. There's an American multinational conglomerate in multiple sectors, including, you know, healthcare, aviation, power, renewable energy, digital industry, manufacturing, one of the largest in the Fortune 500, with, 283,000 employees. That has done a couple of different things. During a major transition, they use systems thinking to help think through and articulate a collective understanding of the shift in the mental model that had to occur to lead the shift in the that needed to occur strategically in the organization, from being an industrial company to a digital industrial company. And there was a whole set of things that had to occur that everyone in the organization really had to understand to make the shift from industrial to digital was a big shift. There's all kinds of other examples. I mean, another example of a kind of at the project level where an international company kind of redesigned an entire technical system because it had, while the technical features were really, really at the top of class, when that, you know, this is a machine that costs, you know, each one costs more than a few million dollars. When it was implemented, it created all kinds of socio-technical problems. So that's what I was referring to before. When you take something like an MRI machine, and you design it, you know, perfectly in terms of the technical specs, but you don't consider some of the human interactions that it's going to have in the world. You can have a lot of failures, even though the machine itself is kind of a marvel of engineering. It's a dud when it comes to how it gets implemented. There's a lot of examples of doing those kinds of things, which sometimes is called design thinking, which systems thinking lies at the base of. trying to think of some other ones. Multinational corporation, a big defense contractor, defense corporation, wanted to, very simple, but very difficult. Their hiring process, they knew they had to get talent, right? Their hiring process basically took about 2 months from application to offer. They wanted to decrease that to 1 day, right? So, well, not from application, but from the point of interview to offer, they wanted to smush that process down into a single day. So that day started in the morning and ended at night, and the applicant went through a battery of things. And what they wanted was an offer, if they wanted to offer at the end of the day. Well, you can imagine that's quite a complex system, and there's a lot of different things that have to happen to get it right, to smush, you know, basically a month, month and a half of stuff into a single day and effectively get the best candidates and give them an offer. Because the research shows that a lot of times the first offer is going to get taken, or increases your probability of getting the person. So, you know, that's an example of just systemic design, looking at how do we design this process of hiring to make it more efficient, so that, and there's a huge outcome, right? Which is we're going to get the engineers we want. We're going to get the, you know, whoever it is that we want in an environment where it's very competitive, right? All these companies are competing for the same engineers. So yeah, that's another example. I can think of others if you want me to. I'm not sure if that answers the question.
This is very helpful, Professor, and I'm sure those watching us today have found your session very helpful. Thank you so much for spending your Saturday morning with us. And okay. And thanks to all our viewers who have taken time to be with us today. We look forward to seeing you in the program. Good day. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.